when I got the advance copy a week ago and I read through it, I suddenly had the feeling that in fact it was I who was being privileged by being asked to release, launch, present this book to the public. At one level, the book is, as was said earlier, about these 10 or 12 cities where she has either briefly or at a slightly longer, for a longer period, spent some time, which she has encountered in terms of people she knew and things she did and the associations that she had. And it's therefore something of what one might call a kind of vignette of a memoir. Not quite a memoir, but a feeling of a memoir. At another level, and that's where I think I come in, there is a history. There is a history of each city in terms of a crisis. At least that's how I saw it. And the crisis is between then and now. And I, of course, came into my own because I've spent my life talking about the crisis of then, the past, and now, the present. And these crises are always linked. And then at another level, it is about something else which is extremely central to our lives. It's about identities. Identities invariably complicate the issues that we are talking about, because you have to think of what are the identities that we want, what are the motives that we have for these identities, are these motives legitimate or not? And there is a certain kind of complexity in this discussion about giving an identity to a person through the way the person lives in the city, who the person meets, and who the person associates with, which complexity is very nicely brought out in these little vignettes of each of the cities that she goes to. The book is therefore, I think, an absolutely riveting read. That didn't surprise me coming from Githa, because I feel that way about practically everything that I have read of hers. But in addition to that, there is a kind of constant provocation of going beyond the obvious thought. And that's exciting. This is largely because it's the background to all these associations and descriptions is the issues that we are facing today in our lives. And every one of us, in a sense, can associate with these issues. But anyway, let me not suggest that the book is about the chitter-chatter that goes with the question of identity. It's not. It's a very serious investigation into this question. It's much deeper, yet it has a universal reality of trying to come to terms to who are we claiming that we are when we assert an identity, and who are we assuming that we want to be when we assert an identity? Because there are always these two aspects to asserting identity. I'll mention just a few of the cities because I think these struck me as being particularly interesting. And the contradictions come through very clearly in terms of what was and what is. George Washington, for example, she tells us, was associated, and quite rightly, with liberal democracy and the creation of America. He had to deal with a slave girl, Ona Judge. And the slave girl ran away and refused to come back. And why did she refuse to come back? She complained of mistreatment. Now, I think this is such a lovely contrast between what George Washington stood for and what the slave girl who'd worked in his household was saying was the actuality. Then there is the creation of the town of Ooty in South India, Ootakamund, which was tied up, amongst other things, with British officers giving an identity to the Toda tribes who lived in the area. And this is really a very fascinating story about how they arrived. They don't know what to do with these people. They're behaving strangely, they dress strangely, they have a language that they can't understand. And so they start looking for origins. And the Todas are essentially cattle keeping, and they revere their cattle very much because their mainstay of life is from cattle. And of course, the biggest surprise, I think, to the Todas was when the British said to them, oh, you're the remnants of the original Aryans. And this, you know, sets off a whole span of thinking about where are the original Aryans, where are the Todas, what is the link, and so on. Then there's this lovely chapter on Japan, and I was very struck particularly by one thing. Githa approaches it by saying, how, for example, do we enter the world of the Japanese? How do we understand Japan? If we do it through these very short poems, the haiku of a poet called Basho. And I was very struck by one in particular that she quotes, which goes like this. Stillness, the cicada's cry drills into the rocks. And I thought that was such a superb juxtaposition. And then there's Palestine, asserting its rights of recognition and its distinctiveness in the face of Israel. This is not the classic case of a once victimized people becoming the oppressors. The Israelis are not victimizing their erstwhile oppressors. They are in a kind of convoluted, mixed-up way, but perhaps not so mixed up when you look at it carefully, assuming the role of their own erstwhile oppressors and oppressing the next person down the line. Githa's thoughts on the cities that she describes raise many, many questions, and I'll only look at a couple of them, which kind of intrigued me as a result of reading the book. The 19th century, as we all know, was the peak of colonialism. And within Europe, it was also the high point of discussion on democracy and political liberalism. But this discussion never took place in the colonies, for obvious reasons. And in fact, when one looks at the syllabus of the three universities that were established, Madras, Bombay, and Calcutta, it is very interesting that the writings of people like Dom Payne and so on were very deliberately and specifically excluded. It was said that these writings were not to be taught in the universities. Again, there is this sense of contrast between what was happening in the homeland, the colonial homeland, and the colony. And it was almost as if the inequalities in the colony subconsciously might have sharpened the sense and the need for freedom and equality in the colonial country. I don't know, but I think this is an interesting kind of interface that perhaps needs to be examined a little further. And in the colony, what was happening in the colony? You had anti-colonial nationalism, relatively secular, with a vision of the coming of an independent nation. After independence, and there's an interesting pattern in this, after independence, there was a brief period of trying to give reality to the vision of an independent nation state, and then it seemed to slowly fade. Subsequently, and in many ex-colonies today, what is sought is not a return to the state as it was prior to colonialism. That's not possible. You can't reinstate something that's gone into the past, or even a different concept of a state, but a return to a kind of nation that is visualized in accordance with colonial readings of the pre-colonial past. In other words, how did the colonial scholars, colonial policy, read the society that they were governing? And people today are busy trying to reconstruct that society and take the colonial readings as their roadmap, as it were. And in a somewhat inverted way, They question these and they become part of an anti-national act. Those that question the bringing back of a colonial vision of colonial society, of the colonized, are treated as anti-national. It would seem that in many parts of the world, there still prevails what I would like to call fag-end colonialism. We haven't got past it. It's not post-colonial. It is still fag-end colonialism. And the colonial view of a nation's culture is taken to be the authentic indigenous culture to which the nation must return, not something that is thought out anew, afresh, and different, but that colonial view is taken as the indigenous culture. It usually endorses a politicized religion as well as social inequalities, especially social inequalities linked to gender. We forget that identities are constructed, and this is something which I think we should always remind ourselves, that there is nothing as a God-given identity or a package called identity which comes down in a culture or a society. We are constantly constructing our identities again and again. Therefore, to understand the intention behind what motivates these identities, the construction of these identities, as are being created in the present, not only here, but in many parts of the world, this becomes imperative. And I would therefore like to thank Githa once again for bringing questions such as these to the forefront and in such a sensitive and compelling way. Thank you, Githa.